It is a Zach Sang show. Dan is here, Heather here is here, and Mike Shinoda from Lincoln Park.
Yes. Woo.
Hello.
Thanks for having me. We've been talking about all kinds of weird stuff. Should we keep talking about weird stuff? What do you guys want to know? What are we talking about today?
I mean, we're just, you know, pitching some ideas, talking about your cool friends.
We turned it into like Shark Tank.
It's good. Do you watch Shark Tank at all? Have you seen the show?
I've seen it, yeah.
It's a very cool. The concept of helping people and keeping America, you know, keeping Americans happy, giving people the American dream,
right.
Helping people achieve their dreams. Yeah. That's very cool.
Yeah, no, I'm into that. Like, I love tech.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we actually have a VC fund, the band does. So
are you investing?
We've been doing it for a little while. I mean, I was doing it on my own before that, and then the band started doing it together at a certain point, and we're invested in, like, it's like Lyft and Blue Bottle and what was the other one? I mean, there's a bunch of them. It's called Machine Shop, but that's not important. The important point is, the reason we did it is not because it's not necessarily like a moneymaker thing as much as it's that the band, I feel like it's always been said, like, that music and technology are so, you know, intertwined.
Yeah.
And for us, like, every time we get together with tech folks, the way of thinking, like, how they want to change the world, you know. Yeah. They want to do things that, like, really make an impact on masses and masses of people all over the place. And I feel like they're pushing, like, society forward, and I want to be a part of that. Like, I want to talk to the people that think that way and do things like that.
But that's it. Music is also a vessel to help have that change come into a reality, right?
I hope so. I mean, it's, you know, sometimes I feel like if I'm like Chris Sacca from Shark Tank.
Shark Tank.
He's invested in all these amazing things. Like, he's physically funding things that, like, in some cases make the world a better place. And I play piano and guitar for a living. Like, it's like, I feel very small, you know? Like, I feel like...
But your message is huge.
I want to think that, like, people listen to the songs and get inspired we have a new song called Heavy, and we can actually talk about what that's about, because this is a song that message is really clear, I think, in the song. So hopefully, you know, a good song about something important, something of substance, can, like, you know, inspire people to live better or make them feel better if they're down.
And the song is called Heavy.
Yeah.
Kiara is featured on it.
Yes.
How'd you pick her? Why her?
Well, it was so funny because she actually, when I first heard about her, she had put out Gold, and it was just on, like, these little indie music blogs. Like, it wasn't a big song yet, and I liked it. It was cool. And a friend of mine I think it was Zane Lowe, and he texted me. He's like, "Hey, do you know Kiara?" And I said, "Yeah, I've heard that one song." He's like, "Man, we just had her on our show, and she's so great." And I asked her what she listens to, like, her favorite band, and she said, without even missing a beat, she said Linkin Park. And that was it. That's all she said. And he's like, "Okay, so she's, like, a massive Linkin Park fan." And I said, "That's so weird, because I would never have guessed that based on her music." And we just got to talking. Like, he put us in touch, and we got to talking, and eventually we wrote the song Heavy, and we felt like it needed a female, like, voice in it that would push that button in your head to go, "Oh, like, this is not just about one person's struggle. It's about more than one person," right? So we put her on the song, and she sang it beautifully, and she's an awesome person.
Is the song written and all done before she comes in, or is she collaborating with you on that?
Yeah, it was.
Done.
In this case, all of our songs on this album, we wrote... usually in our career, we've written all of the songs... like, internally. It's just the band writing, and I'm the kind of the lead writer. Well, me and Brad, our guitarists, are kind of the lead writers. And in this case, this is the first album where we actually brought in a few other people to work with. And so on Heavy, it was Justin Tranter and Julia Michaels.
Cool.
Who, you know.
Cool. Yeah. Well, I know Justin Tranter too. I mean, two huge songwriters.
They're amazing.
Yeah.
And it's funny because they're known, they're so well known for their pop stuff, but they've actually done a lot of other stuff too, from, you know, Fall Out Boy, Imagine Dragons, Julia did stuff with Zedd, like, very versatile writers. And so we saw that on their, like, their credits, and we're like, okay, these, you know, we worked with a whole bunch of people, and certain ones worked out well, and this was one of them. So we had written the song with them, and then brought in Kiara, and it was all good.
Are we nervous as a group when we're inviting people into the inner sanctum?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. In the beginning, the question was, is this something we even want to do?
Yeah.
Like, so we invited, at the end of, it was probably about, like, almost a year and a half ago, We were coming off tour. We were touring a super heavy, like, metal album. Like, yeah. The last album we put out was really heavy. And people ask, like, oh, is that why you, like, chose to go a different direction with the new record? And it's actually not. I mean, we played, it was the biggest touring cycle, the most successful touring cycle of our career. Wow. Bigger than any other one.
Which, so, that's saying a lot.
It does. Dude. So, yeah, we weren't, like, down. We were like, oh, that sucked. I'm really bummed out that record did so bad. Like, it wasn't a pop record. It couldn't get played on the radio. It was too heavy.
It did what it was supposed to do and then some.
Yeah, so we went out on the road. We played these shows. It was super fun. We finished that. And on the way home, I said to our manager, hey, you know, I want to jump straight into writing new stuff. I have a couple ideas of, like, what I want to write, like what I want to do. And I'm curious about writing with other people, not in the band. Because I feel like we've only worked one way, like, inside the band. And while we have lots of different ways of going about writing a song, like, we still don't know how all these other people do it. Like, there's all these people who write country songs in Nashville. Like, what do they do? You know, what are the R&B and people who write for like Rihanna, like, what, how do they go about it? So I was curious about all this, and we set up two sessions in London on my way home from tour. And I worked with a guy named Justin Parker one day, and I worked with a guy named Egg White the
love
next
it.
Day.
Egg White.
His name's Egg White. He's actually, and he's written songs with, like, Adele and Florence and the Machine, like, and some really cool bands, like, more band-related stuff, too. So long story short, met with them, and I loved it. Like, it was just so fun to get new ideas with different people, and with there was, like, a mutual respect, you know? They didn't, like, pitch me a song, like, hey, I wrote this, you guys should play. It was like we sat in a room with a blank sheet of paper, and we said, I would say, well, for the first thing was, I would say, like, I don't know what you do for a living. Like, explain it to me. How does it work to just write a song for somebody else? Like, that sounds so weird. And then we kind of, once I got a feel for all of that, like, we started writing some stuff, and it was cool because the whole process was like, we'd walk in the studio and immediately every day it was like, what do we want to write about? Like, what's on my mind?
Yeah.
And that's a really different way of writing.
But it's also, like, a little bit scary. Before, when you were writing that way, you were sharing your feelings with friends. Now you're sharing it with strangers who kind of just want points on your record.
I think you could think of it that way. If I found that that was actually what you just said, like, if I felt like that was the case,
you wouldn't do it.
We usually didn't work with that person again.
Did you have those feelings while making this record?
Yeah. With some people, it didn't necessarily come from them, but if I felt like it was forced, like, it didn't feel like it had to feel like I'm sitting in a room with friends, right? Or else you wouldn't be open. You wouldn't talk about the stuff that would make a good song. You'd be talking about goofy stuff that was very surfacey and it didn't matter. And it's like, you know, I had to feel like there was a relationship. And we actually probably met with, like, I don't know, 30 or 40 different people at different points. And we only worked with them one at a time. Okay. We never, like, brought in, like, a writer. Like, some, we hear about these stories. Like, I wasn't aware this was a thing, but apparently some artists, like, will bring in, like, a ton of writers and they'll, make a competition out
of
it, right?
People will get houses, will get chefs, and they'll go, their studios set all throughout this house, go and make me songs and then come back and pitch them to me.
So then in those situations, see, this is the polar opposite of what we did, but in those situations you're describing, somebody might say, you know, oh, like, you got all these writers and they'll present you 10 songs and you'll pick the one or ones you like. And the rest of you know, goodbye.
God with you. Shark Tank for music.
Right. So in contrast, and in fact, I found out, maybe this is good for those people to know, but I found out from almost every songwriter that we worked with, I would ask them, what's your favorite way to write a song? What's, like, the best situation if you could have it every day? And they're like, oh, for sure, writing with somebody who's also as good a writer as I am and writing one-on-one.
Wow.
See, they would say every time, they would say, basically what we're doing right now.
That's great.
Like, that's my favorite thing. I do this every day.
Well, because you both are artists, right? So, like, they need to open up too. They need to be vulnerable too.
They want to know that, like, everybody's pitching in, like everybody's capable and competent. And in the case of our stuff, like, I have I can even be a little bit like, well, I know that it's, like, it's our name on the package, right? It's on our name. We're playing it on stage. It's stuck to Linkin Park forever, right? So it has to be, I have to know in my heart that it's, like, this is our song. And so if I feel like it's you know, not quite my thing. Like, I will kill it or I'll redirect it immediately. And I don't waste any time or make any bones about doing that. I will tell them right away. So, and besides that, like, I'm contributive. Like, we're writing the song. So it's,
yeah.
Oh, I don't like this thing. Like, I'm not going to say stop or start over. I'm going to say, what about this? I'm going to say, I'm going to actively change the direction. Cause yeah. Truth be told, like, we could just write the songs on our own, but we wanted to learn and have that like communal collaborative process.
So why did you guys choose Heavy as the first single? Because you don't do that many features.
Yeah, I thought, I mean, for one thing, it's like in terms of the sound,
it's very different.
Of the song, like this album has a different sound. And so I thought Heavy was very core to the sound of the record. So in other words, like, this album sounds like that song. So this isn't like a weird, you know, offshoot track that's like on the outskirts of the album. This is a core song to the album. It's the rest of the album does have that kind of sound. And also it has a feature on it, which is really different for our band. We don't usually do that. But I also felt it was timely, like the subject of Heavy. So the song is about, it's kind of like when that old saying, like, when it rains, it pours, right? Sometimes you find yourself in a situation where just like everything is going wrong. And we had a lot of this, like our guys in the band had a lot of this year, where it could be something really dramatic or big, like, you know, I don't want to like bring the vibe down, but like, like, you know, somebody passes away, or your parents, you know, are having health problems or something like that. That's very substantial. And that on its own would really weigh you down. Mm-hmm. But on top of that, you've got the stuff going on in the news. And on top of that, you've got littler things that just put you over the edge. Like, I came home and my son had the bathtub running and he overflowed the bathtub. He flooded his room. It flooded into the walls
of
and
course.
Then downstairs in the living room, the drywall was falling off the ceiling. And then that caused, like, the floorboards are now warping.
Oh,
and
kids.
And then, like, shortly thereafter, like, we've got ants in the kitchen. Like, just little things. You're like, God, why me? Like, it was enough when it was just the one thing, but now it's five things and I'm going crazy. And this was happening, and those are all real things. Everything I just said, those are real things that happen. And all of the guys, like a lot of the guys, I shouldn't say all, but a lot of the guys in the band had the same thing where they're just like, man, it's not about like just the fact that, oh, why me? It's like, how do you deal with all this stuff when it happens? And the most important line in Heavy is, I keep dragging around what's bringing me down. If I just let go, I'd be set free. Because you know that, like, it's all about your reaction to it, right? Yeah. And so that was a message where, I guess to bring it full circle, like to what we were saying before, like if there's something important we can do in the world as Linkin Park, it's to put out those ideas that we find either helpful for ourselves or we want to like create some kind of community with our fans and with people to say, like, you know, we're all human beings. Like, these are the things that are important.
How do you let it go, right? When that stuff builds up and you need a second, what do you do? What's your escape?
Well, I think for me, I mean, you know, that's a really good question. Cause you kind of have to have, I feel like you have to have like a lot of different like techniques, right? Yeah. Like some days it's like humor. Some days you're just like, this was a really bad day. Like how bad could, like, have I had a day that's, and you laugh about it and you joke with other friends. And like one of the things we would do is like joke about like what else could go wrong. Yeah. Like you'd send yourself on, you set the bar so low.
So low, I can't get any lower.
Like, this is, no, I thought today was bad. Like what if these five things happen? Like how horrible would that? And you start like just, you know, making light of the situation. That for me always helps. And the guys in the band, like we're all good friends. And so we kind of know each other's history and we know each other's like buttons to push.
Yeah.
Like, in a sense, you know? And so that, I think we're a good little support group as friends.
Do you have a vice?
Well, people joke, I mean, this is going to sound really kind of stupid, but, people always joke with me that I need to have like an off switch when it comes to like stuff that I get, like work or stuff that I get obsessed with. And that could be productive. Like I could be like working on a song or working on, you know, I actually do art as well. So I could be working on a painting or something like that. And, I'll start to like not get enough sleep and then it'll be cumulative. Like it's like, oh, I got like 6 hours that night and then 6 hours again, 5 hours and whatever. And I'm like waking up at like 2 in the morning and like management will be getting emails from me at 2 in the morning. They're like, hi, you are, why are you responding to me at 2 a.m.? Now, that's kind of like unnecessary. Like, we don't get in until 9 or 10. Like, I'm not going to read it anyway.
Hard to, like, have it not run you.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it's not like, you know, when I was younger, you know, I would drink and whatever. But I was never like an addictive personality to things like that. Not gambling or anything like that.
But you're addicted to your passion.
But, well, yeah, but it's also being like, especially when you've got like, I've got kids. So like once I had the family element to like balance in and whatever. And
changed
spend time,
everything.
It's, yeah, I have to be, you know, to really like draw a line and say, we're going to like take family time at these times. Like I'm not going to do as much stuff on the weekends just so I can take, you know, my
See, that's
son
cool.
to basketball. And so.
But that also gives you new perspective, right?
Totally.
It changes everything.
Totally does.
Well, the new album, you were saying that it has like a different sound, but all your albums, you guys kind of experiment a little bit. So what exactly did you do differently on this one that you haven't done in the past?
That's a good question. Normally for us, so besides the writing thing, which has always been insular, it's just there's six guys in the band. We're always kind of like running the show. We may have a producer at some point, but for six albums, it's been that way. So to bring in other people and to produce it ourselves, we did that because we wanted to make sure that there was a like the common thread was still us. Like if you have too many other ideas in the pot and
it gets lost.
People, yeah, I felt like it might like run away with another kind of person driving it. But in addition to that, like we actually turned the writing process backwards. So like I kind of said, it was like we'd walk in and, come with an idea first of like, this is the kind of song I want to write about. And the reason that's different is normally like we actually write more like a hip hop production team.
Mm-hmm.
So, we don't usually jam in a room like a band with instruments and whatever. Like, sometimes we don't even know how to play our own song by the time it's done, which is really weird.
That's cool.
It's cool.
But I grew up making hip hop music beats and stuff. So, that's my kind of go to thing. And I play piano. So, that kind of works together. And so usually, up until now, usually what would happen is I'd make a track and the track would sound pretty good. Like done, it would sound pretty good, and you'd see like the track would inspire the vocal. It's like, okay, let's listen to the track and see what the track makes us feel, and then that's what we'll write about.
Interesting.
So this process was totally backwards for me, and it, as simple as it sounds, like it made everything totally different, because you're walking in saying, God, you know, my kid did this, or like my friend said she's having, you know, had this argument with her boyfriend, and it, like, how ridiculous is that? And we'd start talking about that, and we're like, why don't we write about that today? Like, that sounds like a really good song.
Story first, hook second,
right,
and then everything else.
Right.
Right?
That's right. And then we could make, and then it was the joke was like, then we got to have our dessert at the end of the meal, because I love making like
the music
and stuff. Yeah, making the sounds. So it's like, oh, cool, we've got an awesome song. I know the song is good. Like, all I have to do now is put cool sounds on it.
Dress around it.
Yeah, it was fun.
Which do you prefer as somebody who's on both sides of that equation?
I'm going to stick with this for a little bit.
Okay.
That doesn't mean it's going to sound... It's new. This is new. So I've been really enjoying it. But it's... The outcome doesn't have to sound like this album. But I, you know... I guess the bottom line is I really love the process of it. And I also love what this record sounds like. It's been awesome.
Would you ever write for somebody else now after seeing what a songwriter actually does and how it works within a studio?
Yeah, I totally would. And we've actually been talking since we have been talking to all these folks.
You're in a whole new community now.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean,
not new, but you know what I'm talking
about. No, it is in a sense new, because we all do the same thing and we've done the same thing forever. But that collaborative element and the element of like walking into somebody else's personal space and knowing how to be a good collaborator. And I mean, I grew up like, I went to school for illustration and design. So that is to say, like what I was trained to do would be to like make packaging for your CD or to come into an office. Like I wanted to work at one point, I wanted to work at Disney Animation and do, not storyboarding, but they have concept art, which actually, if you ever go in there, what it is for, like, let's talk about, let's say like Moana. Okay. Uh-huh. So the team is working on the animation for Moana, and on the walls, there are these like paintings, huge paintings of the vibe of Moana. So they don't look exactly like what the movie looks like, but they're supposed to give you the emotion of the movie. I loved that. Like, I wanted to do that.
Cool.
And that is actually something that, you know, at the end of the day, like, you're working for somebody else. Like, it's Disney's movie. It's somebody else's story. There are actors, and that's their voices. So you're like playing a role, a collaborative role on this team.
A pivotal role too.
And it's an important role, and you can take pride in it, and you can put your stamp on it. Yes. But it's that. So like, part of me, I know I could never do that 100% for a living, because I need to have a voice that's like my own voice. But at the same time, to spend some time doing it, I've always loved doing that. And I realize now that, like, actually the songwriter process is kind of like that, where you can like write with somebody else and it could be their thing, but you could have an ownership of like your little part of it.
Yeah.
It's
fun. Correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like you kind of take control when you're in the studio. Like, you're at the piano, you're like, all right, let's try this drum beat. You're sitting there with the lyrics, breaking them down, switching words. Like, give a piece of everything.
I don't want to be a control freak, but I can't help it sometimes. and that's for better or worse. Like, and the guys in the band are all like, we have this really great dynamic that other people have seen. Like, other artists have come in to the studio just to hang, or to, you know, even some, you know, in some cases when they come in to collaborate, they see this, the dynamic is like, if we have an idea, if you have an idea and I have an idea and they're not, and they're different, they're like opposing, like, we'll just tell the other person, go, I don't like that.
Okay.
Well, this is why I don't like it. And we try not to say that idea is really stupid and you're an idiot. And you know what I mean? Like,
it happens.
You can't do that. But there is this element of like being really blunt and leaving your ego at the door that is so like crucial to like the way we write. It's like, the ego part is hard. Like, the ego part is the most important part, because you come up with an idea, and if you really like it and other people don't, like, you've got to find a way to like kind of navigate that.
Well, I was going to say, because you and Chester almost seem like two, like, you're so different. So I was wondering, how do you guys
totally
come together?
Are.
And
or do you compliment each other?
Yeah,
we do. It's both. Yeah. It's both. We're like, you know, It's like the what was the thing? It is like the fire and ice kind of thing. Like, mm-hmm. we do things very differently, and he's very passionate, and he's very like, if you say something that he likes, like, you say we should do this, or you say we should do this, and he likes that, he'll be 100% all about that, and he'll walk out the door in like 2 seconds. And you're like, yes, let's go do that, and he's gone. And I'm like, I'm much more like, think about it, and I don't know, you know.
You process it?
I process a little, you know, I'm just...
Yeah, you tear it apart.
I process slower, and sometimes that's really good, and it's very, like, you can slowly, it's more, when it comes to, like, the band, that could be more strategic, or it could be more, like, you take more time to think something through. But he goes nuts, because he's like, finally I come around to the idea, and it's like, now we're in agreement. And he's like, yeah, but dude, I was on board with this like 2 weeks ago. Like, what takes you so long? You know? So
he
has to be patient with me. And sometimes I will come in and it'll be the opposite, where he's like, I'm all about it. And I'll go like, okay, I've thought this through. Have you thought about these three things? Because if not, like, that would be bad. And he'd go like, and then he has to process going through, like, I'm super excited about this thing, and now I'm, like, basically arguing about it.
But that is any good relationship, though, right? Yeah. Right? It's your job. You got to poke holes through it. If you knew it was sound, you'd go for it.
Totally. There's six of us. You know, and it's not just me. And for as different as me and Chester can be, like, we're super good friends, and the other guys are different, too, in different ways, and that are more complicated to explain. That's what makes the band tick. You know, that's what makes it work.
One More Light. The album is coming out on May 19th.
Yes.
Give me some insight into the name, because I can draw my own conclusions.
Oh, okay.
But explain it.
It's actually very specific. This is the first album. One More Light is the first album released by our band that is named after one of the songs.
Oh.
And the song One More Light was actually, it's kind of sad. We had a... That guy, I mentioned that guy, Egg White.
Yes.
Writer Egg White.
Egg
so
White.
I love Egg. He's the sweetest guy. He's really creative and he doesn't like LA. But he made an exception to come out to LA and work with us for a week. And every time I come to LA, I hate LA. Like he's from London. He said, I'll make an exception. So we got through the end of the week. We wrote all kinds of great stuff. And that we found out just before he got here that a friend of ours who worked for the label passed away. She got cancer and it was like really, really fast. It was super sad. We wanted to have somebody from the band at the funeral and it was going to be on Friday. And Brad and I talked about it and he's like, okay, we don't like Eggs come from out of town. We've got to, you know, we don't want to flake on him. Why don't I go to the funeral and you come to the studio with Egg and work for that day? And I was like, okay, that's a good solution. Brad was gone and I was in the studio with Egg and we had been talking about just like I said, like we walk in the door, what's on our mind. And I told him like, dude, there's nothing else on my mind today. Like this is just such a sad day. And he was telling me about, you know, one of his friends who had passed away and we just got on this thing and was like, you know what, like, let's just write about it. Like, I know it's a real, like it's a super intense subject, but we wrote this beautiful song called One More Light. And the punchline, the point of the song is that through all of this, through something really, really traumatic like that, and loss is just like a part of life. Like we can't avoid it. One of the most important things you can do is to let people know that you care. Let people know who are the family or your loved ones who are still with you that you care about them. And so we made it about that. That's what the song is about. And that optimism or that like community that song is about, for as sad as it is, it's also to me, it's a very, very like heartwarming song. It's kind of a bittersweet thing. And it's such a unique song for us that we couldn't help but just name the album after this one song because it's such an important song for the band.
And I know who you're talking about, right?
Yes.
In the past.
Yes.
And I think there's nothing more than that she's going to, I know my best friend was her best friend and that
oh
means a
gosh.
Lot. And I think that's going to mean a lot to, you know, that's beautiful.
That's so crazy.
That's really nice.
I totally did not know that.
No, that's really cool.
We actually played because cool. she worked for our label.
She worked for Warner.
And she was with us like in the radio promo of like our early records. Like she was on board, like part of the team from forever ago. And eventually when we finished the song, we played it just as like a special, like because it was about what it was about. We went to this, they have like a company get together where all these people from all over the, who work for Warner Brothers get together and listen, you know, they talk about what they're going to be up to, but they also just listen to music and hang out and build like that. And we surprised them. We showed up out of nowhere, surprised them at the event and we played them the song.
That's awesome.
And they were like, people were like weeping and they were coming up to us and we're giving hugs and like shared all these stories. So for as sad as it was, like I said, it was very bittersweet. Like we were building more community because of the thing that happened.
And that's beautiful.
Yeah, it was really nice.
What's the sound of that song? Because the way you're describing it sounds like it would be like a Shadow of the Day type song.
Oh, so it's more acoustic. It's very stripped. It's only a few instruments. It's like a couple of like kind of loops and then piano and guitar. And no percussion. Like it's it's really stripped down. But I'm excited for people to hear. It's the album as a whole, that's the only song like that on the album.
Mike, Linkin Park?
You didn't get to half the questions.
Okay.
Rapid fire.
Before we officially wrap, two more questions going to Dan.
I'm going to list them all. One, are you prepared for the criticism from your fans with the new sound?
That's a great question. I mean, I think that's the first thing a lot of people think. We've gone through this exact same thing for many albums. Mm-hmm. You know, the band is all about mixing styles and blending styles. We love to surprise ourselves. We love to surprise our fans. So this is, you know, we've done this thing before where we've come out with an album. I mean, our album, our a few years ago, A Thousand Suns was like a really polarizing album. Mm-hmm. So. It is what it is. I always tell the fans who love, you know, one particular like era of the band more than another. Like at our show, we play all those songs. Like we're not going to be the ones to like come out now and be like, cool, yeah, we're going to play all the new stuff and none of the old yeah stuff.
I hate
screw
that.
You guys. I'm not about dude that. Like I want, and our shows are super, yeah, there's a ton of variety. It's a big journey. Like you're going to get one step closer in this set and you're going to get like heavy in the set, which you yeah can't, obviously you can't put those right next to
no,
each other in the set,
very well,
but they'll both be in there. Okay. And we do find a way to make it all work.
Cool. And how much rapping are you doing on the new album?
Less on okay this album. I'm actually doing more singing on this
wow
album. And it was interesting for me. Like I have never done that. I've kind of like it's been more, I've been singing more and more. It doesn't hurt to be like singing next to Chester.
No,
you know, like 7 days a week. I have the best vocal teacher in the world.
And
by the way, and for the record, speaking of singing, his singing on this record, just as a friend, but also as like a producer, people are gonna be blown away by the voice on this guy. He's always been able to sing this well, but because stylistically it's never been able to shine.
Yeah.
Like I think the first time we covered Adele's "Rolling in the Deep" a couple years ago, and then people went like, "Whoa, wait a minute!
He can sing
yeah really well." And this record, you can hear it.
All right, so I know I'm running out of time here, but if you could choose any rapper today to do another mashup album with, who would it be?
Great question.
I think I have one in mind.
Who's yours? I don't know who I'd say.
You have to think of someone.
I listen to so many people. I mean, like, if you want to go big, I mean, it's obvious ones. It's like Kanye and Drake.
I thought Kendrick could be good with you guys.
Kendrick, yeah,
maybe
obviously.
Chance.
Yeah, I love all those guys. Chance is incredible. You could go down deeper too. You know, I love Pusha T. I love Schoolboy Q.
Oh, that'd be a good one.
I still listen to like at least half the music I listen to is hip hop. So,
cool.
I could do that forever. It's you know, and by the way, like part of it is funny because I hope that we do some remixes of some of these songs.
Like, you usually do the remix albums, right?
You yeah do them.
We recorded more when we were working on this record. We did some rap stuff. I did some verses. I just never really developed them out. So they'll be, you know, they'll probably mm-hmm show up at some point. But for right now, that's not what we've got going on.
What are you thinking?
Well, I mean, I could keep going. I guess I'll ask one more. How do you guys have voices at the end of a show, let alone a whole tour? Because you're going hard.
We got to pace ourselves. Yeah, our show tends to be about 90 to 100 minutes.
Ooh.
And
wow.
When we were younger, we did like, you know, 5, 6, 7 shows. We did a show a night. And we don't, you know, I think that will burn anybody out pretty mm-hmm fast. So we want to be able to tour for like, it could be 18 months on a cycle for a band like ours. So we don't do quite as many at this point.
One More Light is the album coming out May 19th. Is it finished? Are we done?
Yeah, it's done.
You're like ready to go with it. Like if it releases yeah tomorrow, you're okay.
I'll tell you this. We're wrapping it up and there are a couple, we haven't talked about everything. Like there are still some things to talk about. So next time I come on the show,
okay,
and you guys have heard everything, then I know there's some surprises still up our sleeves with the record. But yeah,
we are very excited. So
we have 30 more questions.
I'll just save the rest of them until next time.
Please come back.
Thank you. I'd be happy to.
Thanks for hanging out, Mike. It means a lot.
Thanks for having me.
All right.
Yeah, that's great. Woo!